Thanks, Sanjay, and thanks to the NASIC team for this fantastic gathering here. Now, I'm going to take over in the next 25 minutes about the role of point of care in neonatology. Yesterday, we learned about basics, and from basics, we are going to forward about the bedside utility and how we can minimize a lot of things in our day-to-day practice. So that's what I would like to cover with the simple studies, and we will see where are we are struggling currently in India and then how we can proceed to taking this forward in India. We all know the point of care is actually the bedside test which gives us answer to the focus question. If I have some question in my mind, I don't have to wait for lab for 3 hours. I don't have to wait the radiologist, I don't have to wait the cardiologist, and eventually I need the answer by bedside test and I can take action. And that is how this area has evolved in the last 2 decades. And we have gone so forward that ultimately we are getting answer in 5 to 10 minutes in most of the situation and we can take action. So dear friend, this is a basic overview currently what we are actually doing in the NICUs. If we all know our postgraduate days, probably the one common test we have done bedside from day one is the urine test. And we all know about the importance of the protein and hematuria and reducing substances, so I will not go into the depth of that one. The important marker in neonatology, after the temperature, we all think about the glucose. I think we all are doing that as a bedside, and that's a fantastic tool about our diagnosis, about our outcome, and about our prognosis. This changes our outcome in the point of care. What we all are also doing in the last 2 decades is actually the ABG and lactate. Most of the NICUs have a bedside ABGs, and that gives you lactate and BSL. The additional points have come out, I'll come to that 2 and 3, that one. The few NICUs have gone up one step ahead, and they have instrument now which includes your hemogram, that gives you your coagulation profile, and that also gives you electrolytes. That I'll explore in 1 minute. I think the last decade, one of the good things happened probably is again TCB machine, and the TCB machines have reduced our sampling or improved the basic outcome. I have included the OE machine also, probably that's out of the top range, but OE also acts as a point of care testing, and that could be included. I was just talking with Tushar in the morning, and he says that that could be the future for OPDs also. So that is one more aspect we can think about the OE. What I want to concentrate more, as you all know, that's my passion, or we all are working towards hemodynamics, that every organ we think about ultrasound. And that is where point of care ultrasound has helped us in India, or evolving the branch as a full branch as a neonatology. We are already doing since 1980s as a part of the curriculum in the UK as a cranial ultrasound. The functional echo started in the again UK and Australasia since 1998, and curriculum wise it's in 2007. That is already in the pipeline. But what has happened in this decade is use of the lung ultrasound and use of the gut ultrasound and lines position, which we'll cover associated with the procedure skills about the use of ultrasound. So these are the broad perspective what we are currently using as a point of care in neonatology. By and large, these tests covers most of your gamuts about the neonatology, and then you don't have to wait for a lot of time about utilizing this one. I think when I ask my DM students, they always say that, sir, we take 50% of the additional blood. And when I was my resident myself, I used to give 1 vial additional in the fridge. And you can imagine a baby who is 800 gram keeping the additional blood, and then you can imagine how much blood we are as blood sucking doctors. We always say that. We are taking a lot of blood from the baby. Most of the babies land up with iatrogenic anemias. Almost 30 to 40% blood loss in the first 10 days of life. Yes, we are going actually reducing the test. And the issue is that, in spite of that, there is a need of the blood transfusion. And hence, these are the machines came out in the market since 2000. These are the two companies they have been actually using. One of the corporate hospital into the country, they are using this machine very well because they don't have a lot of support system from the lab, and they are very happy with these systems. The every CT, when I asked, myself I'm not using, but when I was asking few consultant neonatologists, every CT there are 2-3 neonatologists, they are using this machine as a point of care testing to check hemoglobin, to check coagulation profile and check electrolytes, BSL and lactate associated with the bilirubin also. You take 0.3, 0.5 ml blood and you get the results. And correlation is good, not bad. And hence, various tests have been done, various studies have been done, and the correlation is good. And hence, those hospitals, they are standby hospitals, where the sending lab becomes very tough, the teaching hospital will be difficult. I'm sure that there is already pathology lab, already diagnostic lab, already metallurgy lab. So that is difficult. But the hospitals which are standalone, this could be the easy solution. But naturally, we need to correlate very well with this one. These are the two machines available in the country currently. You need to bargain about the cost, probably. That's not our area. I don't have to talk about the TCB. Every hospital has TCB. Every consultant unit has TCB. And I will not discuss about too much about the TCB. How the things have changed about these ones. Again, every teaching institute, again corporate hospital, the OE is mandatory. And it's a part of our now curriculum as a hearing screen. So that's also I consider as a point of care testing. What I am going to concentrate in next 20 minutes is this flow. Probably this one slide covers what we are currently doing for the point of care unit ultrasound in the probably in the country or probably overall. I already told about the various aspects of the point of care, but my focus will be now mainly on the research aspect. About how this point of care ultrasound will be useful for all of us in the future as a future leading technologies, future leading associations, decreasing the cost, procedure evolving, and the lines position. So, I already mentioned that this is the focus, this is the bedside, this is the real time. You immediately see the baby, you immediately see the action, and you can monitor serially, you can check the function, you can decide the physiological action. And from that action, you can recheck again. That is the full cycle of the point of care ultrasound in the various organs, and that is very, very useful in all day-to-day care practice. What is this point of care use of focused question and focused answer? Is this baby has a hemodynamic with PDA? Is this baby has a pulmonary pressure which needs a treatment? Is the contact rate is okay? Is the cardiac output is okay? Is the preload is also okay? Or there is intracranial bleed or intraventricular bleed? Any of these questions, yes or no answers, you immediately get. Once you get the answer, you act. And once you act, you see the results in the next 4 to 6 hours. And these are the things going actually since last 2 decades. We know that. What happened in this decade also, which is important, is actually the lung ultrasound. You immediately do the lung ultrasound, you immediately see does baby have the IDS, does baby have the TTN, does baby require surfactant therapy. You don't have to wait. In the best of the best hospital, you take almost 30 minutes for your digital x-ray. You don't have to wait. You need 2 minutes and 5 minutes, you get these answers, whether you are dealing with the pneumonia, whether you are dealing with the TTN or RDS and those things. Naturally, the pleural effusions and the pneumothorax, day by day they are coming down, but still you can recognize. One of the most important thing I feel is the lying position. Naturally, the day-to-day practice, all the residents putting UAC, UVC, endotracheal tube and PICC lines, immediately you side by side on bed, you check the positions of the lines. You don't have to wait for the x-ray for 1 hour or 2 hours, whatever the situation. So these are the questions you get. To this, few of you already seen few cases, but I'll summarize and I'll go ahead over these cases. This is the outbound baby. We do get all the lot of patients, we get outbound 1.4 kg, a 34 weeker on day 4 deteriorated with naturally the apnea, bradycardia or severe acidosis and lactate and ventilation required with hypotension. We all know the diagnosis, but how this changes about the situation, I will try to correlate with this one. So this baby has a bidirectional PDA. This is a late onset sepsis, what we are thinking at present moment, with a bidirectional PDA. You can see the PDA which is left to right as well as right to left. This bidirectional PDA associated with your high cardiac output. The normal cardiac output in the babies, what we consider after day 4, day 5, is between 200 to max 300 ml per kg per minute. So this baby who is dealing with a late onset sepsis, preferably we are thinking gram-negative sepsis, and preferably where we are thinking high output failure, where we are thinking vasodilatory shock, naturally, that's where we did a study 2 years before, We have 52 babies and we actually checked the right ventricular output and left ventricular output. Most of the babies with the sepsis of the right ventricular output and left ventricular output is more than 300 ml per kg per minute. So what we think that the babies in India with the gram negative sepsis, especially Klebsiella and Acinetobacter, which is common in Indian scenarios, we have seen that these babies have a high cardiac output. In this baby, also, we did a lung ultrasound. So this lung ultrasound shows the picture of the pneumonia. So this baby has a bacteremia, this baby has a pneumonia. My additional thought process changes by lung ultrasound. That's a classic lung ultrasound picture of lymphatization, and that's a classic picture of pneumonic effusion when you consider the lung ultrasound. So this baby is not only have a bacteremia or a gram-negative sepsis or bacterial sepsis, along with that we have to think about this one. And hence, the resident has decided to do lumbar puncture. So before the lumbar puncture, they did a spinal ultrasound. Spinal ultrasound to check the position of the vessels to avoid traumatic taps. This is a simple way, put an ultrasound probe, see the vessels, mark the vessels, and just adjust into the lumbar puncture. 99% you are non-traumatic taps. That's the role of ultrasound for procedures. This baby's ultrasound, naturally the CSF done, CSF turned out to be turbid, hence cranial ultrasound done. This baby, you can see the cranial ultrasound, actually a massive dilated ventricles with ventricular wall problems, with internal echoes, you can see the classic example of a gram-negative ventriculitis. So it's a gift of India, we do get such cases. But then what happened, in the 15 minutes, you got all the organ screening. You immediately see that the things are changing, your thought process is changing. This is another patient, but gram-negative sepsis with brain abscess. A rare organism, but brain abscess by the brain ultrasound. So what we saw in these babies of brain abscess, we saw the reversal of flow in the anterior artery. This is a case report we published in Journal of Neonatology. From this case report, we decided to do the study and to find out, does the anterior artery Doppler changes in late onset neonatal sepsis? And hence, we published this study, which is going to come in December 2019 now. We have taken 1 year data about late onset sepsis and 33 babies of late onset sepsis, which are culture positive, where we have done this anterior artery Doppler. What is surprising with this one, this is the normal Doppler. This is the normal Doppler, and this is the reversal of the flow. The late onset gram-negative sepsis in India is associated with absent or reversal of the flow. Almost 55% of the babies who had absent or the reversal of flow. And that is additional clue what we got when we are doing this one. This absent or reversal could be because of bidirectional PDA, and mainly associated with the Klebsiella and Acinetobacter. So this is how the reversal of flow helped us in interpretation of this gram-negative sepsis in Indian scenario. Additionally, we have done the hip ultrasound of this baby. And this hip ultrasound shows hip abscess. My treatment duration changes. My diagnosis is there, but duration of the treatment changes by hip ultrasound. But that is also additional. Naturally, the resident has decided to put the lines. They inserted the line, and you can see the inserted line, the line is in the LA. This is the LA, this is the UVC in the LA. You don't have to wait for X-ray. The line is in, you can see in the LA, immediately line pulled by 1.5 cm and the next position was correct. So, line position was confirmed in this baby. Baby was intubated before that. This is the endotracheal tube position and this endotracheal tube position confirmed by ultrasound. Again, in the 15 minutes gamut, you have screened the blood, you have screened the lung, you have screened the abdomen, you have screened the hip, you have screened the brain, you have screened the lung position. What has happened in these babies that you dramatically change the scenario naturally, hence we did another study that how the sepsis babies ultrasound helps. What percentage of the babies will require ultrasound? And then another study done by our team around near about 67 culture positive sepsis. You can see 45% of the babies of late onset sepsis has a brain ultrasound abnormalities. Around 80% of the babies have hemodynamic problem. Around 30% of the babies have a lung ultrasound problem. And the lying position was also there in 10% of the babies. So this is the, most of the babies will have grade 1, grade 2 IVH, but we did find ventriculitis and hydrocephalus in babies also. So late onset sepsis, we need to screen mainly all organs also associated with the, I just told you about ultrasound and impaired cardiac output, impaired contractility, and impaired pulmonary pressures. So the ultrasound has helped us in management of these various organs. Naturally, these are the four papers in pipeline that ultrasound with late onset sepsis with secondary pulmonary hypertension, bidirectional PD association and closure of the PDA, reversal of ACA flow with a bad outcome, and absent and reversal of SMA flow in late onset sepsis. These four papers are already ready, but we're just waiting for publication, and then we'll show you that one. So these are the associations of the late onset sepsis. Naturally, this case has got us lost. One case, I got to select the antibiotics, I got to select my inotropes, I got to prognose the baby's condition, I could able to see other organ involvement, I could able to decide duration of antibiotics, I could able to see the lying position. So it has a lot of things by ultrasound. You will say, if ultrasound is not there, yes, it happens. It's not like that. We are doing clinical practice. It does happen. It takes time. I'm trying to say time duration is less. I'm trying to say it helps. It is a mandatory nowadays. It helps in your outcome. A few cases, another India's gift, meconium aspiration, severe pulmonary hypertension, hypoxia, naturally. The echo shows severe pulmonary hypertension. Pulmonary pressures are 67. If you have the residents or DM candidates who are doing this immediately and taking action, that use of the pulmonary vasodilators, whatever the Indian pulmonary vasodilator available or the nitric oxide available, you decide and take action by this mechanism. So my management changes, my immediate action changes because there is a pulmonary hypertension, and we can use immediately depending upon what is unit protocol, you decide that one. And you can monitor 6 to 12 hourly or 24 hourly. Monitoring is more important, and that gives you idea. This is another baby who is a 26-week or 700 gram with hypotension on day 2 of life. Baby was extubated, but baby has actually come from the outgoing. Hence, at 48 hours, we did echo, and then echo shows a classic hypotension was because of the classic hemodynamic PDA. This is a 3-leg view with the PDA, with the LAA dilatation, with reversal of flow. You can see the reversal of flow in this baby, which is a classic absent and reversal of flow. So this baby has hemodynamic PDA. If I start becoming the better adrenaline, it's not going to help me. Ideally is that this baby, naturally, as per the protocol, I have to start treatment of my unit, whatever the treatment unit I have, whether I will propane or paracetamol, what you are deciding, we need to think. So treatment changes by immediate ultrasound, by diagnosing hemodynamic PDA. This is a baby with hypoxia, parental depression, borderline blood pressure, poor capillary fill, acidosis. This also gave us that there is a problem with the contractility, there is a problem with the cardiac output. This is a case for therapeutic hypothermia. We need to use that, associated that. This baby also has a decreased cardiac output. Naturally, I need to use the inotropes, which are improving the cardiac output. Day by day, that will change my scenario. This is the RI of this baby. You can see the diastolic. Diastolic is too high. RI is 0.4. Naturally, I have to think about MRI and extend the prognosis in this baby. When the RI is less than 0.5, the prognosis is problematic, associated with other markers. That has given the panel ultrasound clue to me. So this is where additional help happens. Naturally, the selection of drugs and those parameters happens. And that's what 3 years before we published another paper that use of the functional echocardiograph in India. And naturally, we have the PDA and DPHN and hemodynamics. These are the common things we can work out about those ones, this one. This is a baby, classic baby. Again, this happens in India. 25-week-old, born in PSC. And this is the first male child after 3 girl childs. I should not say that, but this is a fact in India. This happens. They came to us, do everything, we'll spend money now. You can see the whiteout x-ray, you can see the whiteout lung ultrasound, and baby was pale. Naturally, the surfactant was planned, immediately all those things planned, but in this baby, the massive periventricular hemorrhagic infarction. Now tell, as a neonatologist, a 25-week-old with a massive periventricular hemorrhagic infarction within 6 hours, how many of us will dare to be surfactant? How many of us will start the treatment thinking and long-term outcome? This has changed my thought process that, oh, whatever the circumstances or social circumstances, I cannot do that. This outcome is bad. High chances of death and high chances of bad outcome. This is where ultrasound has helped us. This is another baby who is a 36-week-old with a severe pulmonary hypertension. You can see the TRJ. And this baby, also we did a cranial ultrasound. any resident, they can find out this is a mass and this mass in the brain has AV malformation. Immediately interventional radiologist is involved, baby has actually been failure, that got corrected after the treatment, after the interventions. So another baby who is unregistered with cyanosis, with a distress, with a metabolic acidosis, while doing the functional echo, immediately in my unit, rather than X-ray, the functional echo does first, and you can see this baby has, in the functional echo, there is a mass in the heart. Naturally, once you find mass in the heart, you turned out to the various organs, and hence, eye, naturally there is a retinal astrocytoma. We again saw the brain, cranial ultrasound, there is a cortical tumor. MCM done the MRI, confirmed the diagnosis of the tuberous sclerosis. Genetic consultant called all the family, and two more members of the family diagnosed tuberous sclerosis. Yes, it's going to diagnose eventually, but the diagnosis made on day 4 of life of all family members is important when we consider other additional things. This is another unregistered patient, 35-week-old, requiring delirium intubation, severe pulmonary hypertension, LV dysfunction, and hence the lung ultrasound done. The lung ultrasound shows this massive effusion. Naturally, you can see this is fluid, this is the lung. You require drain, you require ICD, and that turned out to be chylothorax. Naturally, the treatment, thought process changes, outcome changes. This is where the ultrasound helps. The lung ultrasound is the big man. I think you see the last 10 years, every month one paper on lung ultrasound from some units. Lots of uses, fantastic outcomes. This is a classic example of the lung point in the pneumothorax. You could able to see this is the normal lung, but this is the lung with the pneumothorax. Day by day, once you pick up more, you will learn more. This is a classic M4 sign of the pneumothorax. And these are the ones, various, you can see that normal, abnormal pattern of the pneumothorax. There is a good sensitivity and specificity of lung ultrasound as with reaching around 90-95%. So I request all young guns, learn the lung ultrasound. That's the future and that's very important. Naturally, the American Academy published the technology of the lung ultrasound and they are thinking to include their curriculum as lung ultrasound. This is one more patient, 27-week-old, initial required CPAP, insure, brufen, but baby deteriorated at 22 days of life. Naturally, sometimes the course doesn't go as per the plan, and hence, you can see the abdominal ultrasound. This is a portal in gas. This baby, with this is ascites, and this is a portal in gas, and you can see the X-ray with the classic NAC with the portal in gas. Immediate involvement of the surgeon, immediate action, and then void. The last case, this baby came on day 23 for 3 intubations and 3 extubations. With hypoxia, PO2 is always 50. Naturally, as a neonatologist, you always say that this is nothing but TFBC. But two different cardiologists done the echo and they said structurally normal heart. Hence, we did echo along with that I did liver ultrasound. And in the liver ultrasound, I could see the pulmonary veins here. I have not spoken to the pediatric cardiologist, and as a little bit liberty, I did the CT angio pre-op cost. 2 pulmonary veins were going to the LA and 2 were going to the liver, partial UTC. Because I didn't want it to hurt my cardiologist. After the report, I told there is a partial UTC. Immediately baby shifted, immediately baby operated, and baby is doing good. So this is the role, what we need to work out when we work in collaboration. Naturally, the procedures also helps, like a pleural tap, ascites tap, pericardial tap. All these taps are useful when we do the ultrasound. This is the protocol we have prepared when the baby has sudden deterioration. This is the things we need to see in cardiac ultrasound. This is the thing we need to see in the cranial ultrasound, lung ultrasound, abdominal ultrasound, and the lying position. And this is the protocol accepted by the CCBU as Australian Society, and they are using the Professor Martin Klopo as our team members. We are using this protocol when the baby deteriorates. Another research we did is to find out the RI before and after transfusion, but we haven't found any change about the RI in these babies of the pre and post transfusions. Naturally, this is a part as a learning curve. It is not a one day thing. It takes time. Today we are doing since last 15-20 years, but still we are learning. Day by day we also make mistakes. So ownership is very important. Gaining experience is important. Achieving competency is important. This is a CCPU course started in 2007 in Australia. Similar courses are started. Our team is conducting plenty of workshops. Our next workshop is in Hyderabad, Yopam. That will be 45th workshop of echocardiography. And hemodialysis conference is also there on the next day. So that's our team. Various society has published guidelines about the point of care ultrasound. This is the US which are guidelines published. These are the articles we have written for Indian pediatrics about point of care ultrasound for head, lung and back and nine positions. This is for general neonatology for lung ultrasound, and this is basically for the neurosonography for NNF guidelines, what we have written in the NNF book as the neurosonography guidelines. This is the book who are a resident and who are the those who want to learn. This is the book our team has published, and the book is freely available. You can take this book with the point of care ultrasound and neonatal cardiology. This is a small book about the functional echo made easy, which you can access. And this is the Atlas last year we published in our hemodynamics conference or Maniopan conference, Atlas of Point of Care Cardinal Ultrasound, which gives all the pictures of the cardinal ultrasound. This is the webinar done by the Somerset World Authority about the Point of Care Ultrasound. You can access this whole lecture on the web, on the webinar on YouTube, which is freely available. Those who are interested, they can go through this one. We did an Indian survey about the Point of Care Ultrasound. The brain and echo or functional echo is gaining momentum. Most of the institute, 60-70% they are using. The lung and gut is now, people are trying to learn. And this paper also is going to publish, is already in the Journal of Neonatology about this publication, about ultrasound. Most important is the limitations. It is not one day thing, it is not 6 month thing, it is not 1 year thing. Learn. Lots of learn. It's operator dependent. And India, one more problem is the PCP entity. You need to have a friendship with your collector and commissioners. Then you can easily access certificate and you can keep the machine in your NICUs. That's what I would say as the limitations. I believe the portable ultrasound is the future, and I believe that's the stethoscope for all of us. Naturally, basics is always there, but along with basics, we need to work on these modalities. This is the future. It's already there in the US with a few institutes. They are already working on these type of things. So yes, these are the important facilities what we have. What we think about the future is keeping the ultrasound machine in your OPD, which we started since last 6 months, and those follow-up babies, immediately you can scan and you can screen for your follow-up IVH, follow-up PVL, and request your radiology team to collaborate with this one. So that's where your ultrasound machine helps in your OPD also, along with your OE, along with your TCB, and along with your those other parameters. So that would be the future of neonatologist OPD, what we think about the associated parameters in the OPD. Those who are young ones, those who want to do something different than nebulization and vaccination, this is the future. Think on this. That would be the point. That's what I'm trying to say. You need to be something additional. And what is additional? This is additional, what you need to work out well before. There is a separate journal on the point of care. There is a journal on point of care, so it's not a new thing. It's a big thing, it's a old thing. We need to utilize this one. So I believe this slide is the summarized slide from my side, that these are the things we can utilize from the point of care testing. And the last is the point of care ultrasound. And in the point of care ultrasound, we can think about ultrasound for critical assessment, ultrasound for screening and monitoring, ultrasound for procedures, ultrasound for preparation of the line placement, and ultrasound for research. Naturally, you will think, oh, this is something great. You will think that I need to learn, but learning is the first step. Day by day, gaining experience is most important. I believe that we all are there, we all are learning phases, and we can improve all these parameters of equivalence in India, and we can take our forward. Thank you. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep, father of point of care of Maharashtra.